Okay, so welcome back to this next video on clathrin-mediated endocytosis, where we're specifically looking at the role of the proteins dynamin-1 and endothelin. Okay, so we've now seen the role of these proteins in pinching off the clathrin-coated vesicle bud. Okay, so we're now going to look at some experimental correlates of this process. Okay, so the first one I want to talk about is something known as the Shibori mutant in Drosophila. Okay, so the Shibori mutant. So basically, the Shibori mutant is a type of Drosophila. Okay, so Drosophila is a fruit fly. It's the full proper name for a fruit fly. So basically, what a Shibori mutant is, so if I draw a little fruit fly here, so here's our little fly. Okay, here are its wings. Coming here. So a Shibori mutant fly is a fly which has a mutation, a complete loss of function mutation, two loss of function mutations, because remember it will have two genes. So it has loss of function mutations in both genes for dynamin 1. Okay? So it has no dynamin 1 functioning. Now, what do you think you are going to see in this fly? Well, let's think about what we've seen that dynamin 1 does. Dynamin 1 is responsible for pinching off the clathrin-coated vesicle pits. It's responsible for oligomerizing around the neck and then hydrolyzing GTP so that it can then tighten around that neck and pinch the vesicle off. Okay? Now, I know endothelin has some role in that, but dynamin 1 is more important than endothelin, okay? And if you don't have any dynamin 1, basically you don't get proper endocytosis of membrane back into axon terminals, okay? So you don't recycle the membrane to make more synaptic vesicles. So very quickly, you run out of synaptic vesicles. If you have no synaptic vesicles, then you have no neurotransmitter to release, so you can't have any action potentials. So these flies, these Shibori mutant flies, are completely paralyzed, and they don't live very long. Okay, but they are paralyzed. Okay, and if you look at the neurons within these Shibori mutants, what you see is, if we look at the axon terminal, you'll see absolutely loads of little pits. So you'll see loads and loads of these clathrin-coated pits, basically. Okay, like so. All over the axon terminal will be these clathrin-coated pits, and I've had enough of drawing them now. So, what's happening? Well, basically, all the other stages of endocytosis are happening, i.e., target proteins are there, you're recruiting the adapter proteins, you're then recruiting the clathrin is polymerizing to make these clathrin-coated vesicle buds here. However, if dynamin 1 is not functioning, you just cannot pinch these clathrin-coated vesicle buds off. So, you end up with this appearance where you have absolutely loads of clathrin-coated vesicle buds. So that's what these are. These are clathrin-coated vesicle buds, but you just can't actually pinch them off. So this is a clathrin-coated vesicle bud. So that's useless, basically. So, this is a nice experimental confirmation of the role of dynamin 1, and indeed, actually, this was how we found dynamin 1. We found it in the Shibori mutant Drosophila. Okay, right, so the next experimental correlate, what we can do is we can take a perfectly normal neuron, okay, and we can effectively turn it into this same thing as the Shibori mutant. We can stop dynamin 1 from functioning. Now, in Shibori mutants, they actually didn't have any functional dynamin 1. What we're going to do is the dynamin 1 will still be there, but it just won't be able to function. Okay, so let me explain how we're going to do this. So, let's say we have an axon terminal here. What we're going to do is we're going to douse this axon terminal in something known as GTP gamma S. Okay? Now, this is an analogue of GTP, of guanosine triphosphate. However, it's non-hydrolyzable. The GTPase, dynamin 1, will take the GTP gamma S in, it'll take it into its active site, but it won't be able to hydrolyze it. So effectively, it's a competitive inhibitor of dynamin 1. So let me discuss with you why GTP gamma S is unhydrolyzable. What is different about it compared to normal GTP? Okay, so let me discuss the structure of GTP. So we'll have, this is going to get a little bit biochemistry-ish. We're going to actually draw the full structure of GTP, just for the sheer fun of it. So, let's go. Molecular structures galore. Okay, so we'll start with the ribose sugar here. So, the ribose sugar is this five-membered ring, where the first member up here is oxygen, and then the other four members are carbon. And all the bonds within this ring are single bonds. You then have the fifth carbon coming off up here. Okay, now we'll come back to that later. Let's start with the organic base that's bound over here. So let's start with the guanine organic base. And I'll just lengthen this bond a bit so that we've got a bit more space up here. So, the guanine organic base then. So, the guanine organic base is what's known as a purine. Okay, so a purine. Now, a purine means that it has two rings, an imidazole ring and a pyrimidine ring. So let's start with the pyrimidine ring up here. Now, the pyrimidine ring is a six-membered ring where two of the members are nitrogen and the other four members are carbon. So, here are the six members of this ring. This is a pyrimidine ring. Now, in pyrimidine rings, the nitrogen atoms, the two nitrogen atoms, need to have a single carbon in between them, like this. Now, in the pure pyrimidine ring, you would have double, alternating double and single bonds. Let me show you up here the structure of the pure pyrimidine ring. So the pure pyrimidine ring is this six-membered ring like this, okay, where you have alternating double and single bonds. So here are the alternating double and single bonds. And then to finish this, you then add the hydrogens to make up the remaining bonds. And so basically, it's like a benzene ring where you've got two nitrogens taking the place of two carbons, and these nitrogens, they only need three bonds, so they don't need hydrogens coming off them. So this is a pure pyrimidine ring. Now, we've got the pyrimidine ring in guanine, so actually, this double bond here isn't going to actually be as a double bond. Instead, you're going to have a carbonyl group here, and then off this nitrogen, you're going to have a hydrogen. So you're going to have cleaved that double bond there, just down to a single bond. But these two double bonds, here and here, remain. In addition, off this carbon here, instead of a hydrogen, you have an amino group, so an H2N group there. Okay, now, in addition, we're talking about a purine, not a pyrimidine. So we need to add the second ring, and it's going to be here, and unfortunately it's going to be slightly distorted because I have to connect it somehow to here. So you have a nitrogen here, then another nitrogen here, and then a double bond to a carbon here. Now this is what's known as an imidazole ring, so let me draw this up here. So a ring that has the structure like this, a five-membered ring with two nitrogens here, and then a carbon up here, like so. This is known as an imidazole ring. So, imidazole. And the reason for that is that the imide bond is a bond between, a double bond between a nitrogen and a carbon atom. So this is an imide bond. So that's why it's called the imidazole ring. Imide for the imide bond. Dazole, because it's got two nitrogens in. Okay, and in the pure imidazole ring, you then have hydrogens off the carbons to make up the correct number of bonds, and you also need a hydrogen off that nitrogen there. Now, here we have that structure rotated slightly. Sorry, yes, you can't see that. We have this structure rotated slightly and slotted in with the pyrimidine ring. So all we need to add then is a hydrogen off there, and that's the pure organic base there, bound now to the ribose sugar here. Okay, so this first carbon of the ribose sugar here will have a hydrogen off it as well as the organic base. Then this second carbon here will have an alcohol group and a hydrogen off it, and that's an important difference between the ribose sugar here and the deoxyribose sugar that you would have in DNA. In DNA, you would not have this alcohol group off the second carbon. So deoxyribose is more fully 2-deoxyribose to denote that it's removed the alcohol group off the second carbon. Okay, then the third carbon here would have an alcohol group and a hydrogen. The fourth carbon would have a hydrogen. And then this fifth carbon here will have 2 hydrogens. So I'll draw those there and there. And now it's going to have phosphate groups linked to it. Okay, right. So let's have this first phosphate group linked to the alcohol group of this fifth carbon. So here is the first phosphate group. I'm going to have to go bend this structure down here unconventionally. Then it's esterified by a phosphate diester bond to another phosphate group. Okay, so here's another phosphate group. We'll have the double bond up there, O minus, and then O. And then finally, you'll have another phosphate group here. Okay, like so. And this, finally here, this is the structure of guanosine triphosphate finished. Now, so guanosine triphosphate is here. Now, how do you change this to guanosine triphosphate gamma S? Well, you actually only change one atom. I know, I drew that entire thing out to change one atom. Okay, so you change this atom here, this oxygen. And this tells you exactly what to do with this. So GTP gamma S, this here is the gamma phosphate here. So you take GTP, you take the gamma phosphate, and you replace this oxygen with a sulfur. So take the oxygen out and replace it with a sulfur atom, and you get GTP gamma S. This gamma phosphate now has a sulfur atom there instead of the oxygen. Now, the effect that that has is it stops any enzyme from chopping this gamma phosphate off. The sulfur stops the phosphate from being chopped off. So the GTP is almost identical, so it goes into the active site just like a normal GTP. The GTP gamma S is almost identical to the GTP. So it will go into the active site specifically of our dynamin 1 protein, and it will inhibit that dynamin 1 protein. It won't be able to be hydrolyzed, so the dynamin 1 won't be able to get the energy it needs to constrict the neck of the clathrin-coated vesical pit. So instead, what you will just get is you'll get the dynamin 1 forming these spirals around the neck, but then not being able to actually constrict, so not being able to actually pinch off the vesicle. So instead, what you get is you get these light bulb-like structures emerging here. Okay? So you've got the clathrin-coated vesicle here. Okay, and then you've got the neck, which will be surrounded by dynamin 1. So let me draw this out bigger down here. So here's our our clathrin-coated vesicle pit at the moment. It's not a vesicle yet because it hasn't been pinched off. Here's the clathrin coating it here. Okay, and then around the neck, you then have this dynamin 1 protein, which isn't constricted yet, okay? So here's the dynamin 1 protein, because it's been inhibited by the GTP gamma S, so it cannot hydrolyze the GTP gamma S, so it's just being inhibited by it, so it can't constrict. So basically, what you get is loads of these, and the axon terminal just fills up with these. And what you can do is you can stain with antibodies against the clathrin. So here's our antibody against the clathrin here. So here's our antibody against clathrin. And we can attach fluorophores onto the antibody. So here's some sort of fluorophore. So we can visualize the clathrin. So you'll see the clathrin coating this sort of, this bulb of the light bulb, okay? The glass bulb, if you like. And then the stem of the light bulb here, if you stain with a anti-dynamin antibody, so here's our anti-dynamin antibody, again attached to some sort of fluorophore, then we obviously we'll use different colour fluorophores, then we'll see that the dynamin is localised around the neck, okay? And indeed you can do this experiment where you block the dynamin activity with GTP and gamma S, and you do indeed see these light bulb structures when you stain with these antibodies against clathrin and dynamin attached to fluorophores. Okay, so in the next video we'll look at one last experimental correlate relating to endothelin, and unfortunately it's going to make things a little bit more complicated.